All right, there we go. Now I can't hear him. He's got the records up there.
Never before in all our history have these forces been so united against one candidate as they stand today. They are unanimous in their hate for me, and I welcome their hatred.
The needs of working families in the middle class, not just the billionaire class. We know what's going on, and we are paying attention.
Good morning, everybody. It is most definitely the end of the corporate age. Oh, hey, look at me today. I never have anything going on. That's brand new hair there, flying all over the place. That cover story, that cover card. I'm looking at Springfield. Good morning. I'm gonna balance it out. Okay. The cover card is repugnant. That's Sheriff's Department in Tennessee, and they are torturing a teenager, had over 40 taser burns on his body. Not really sure what the justification was for that. The audio, you can hear the guy say, I'll do this till the batteries run out. That's the kind of cop he is. I don't know what it is with sheriffs. Anyway, I'm gonna move right on from that. We know we got a problem. Next story is actually in my mail. But before we go to that, I wanna say hello. So good morning, Jupiter and Barbara and Bev and Kat and how you doing? Eco and Springfield Density. Good morning. Good morning. I'll be sending you a package back in the same box, Density. Just to let you know. That's what's going on. I'm not. So, let me know if you guys hear weird audio stuff, because it's doing weird stuff for me. And I'm going to have to fix that when we go to running a video or something. But anyway, good morning, everybody. Who else is here? Brad, nice to see you. Yeah, I do have a God complex. Absolutely. With my hair or the cops? Either or. I really do. As much as I say I don't give a shit about my hair, I actually do. It's been this thing since I was a kid. It sucks. It's terrible. I'll just admit that right now. I just will. Anyway, I'm going to turn people's audio back on. We got Deniz here today. We got Markus here today. Who else is here? Steve Collins is over here getting in trouble with the law already for just being somewhere before curfew. I'm not even going to get into it right now, but he's already occupying Corvallis, basically. At least right by the river, which is fine. That's, I just, cops, what are we going to do? It's a little fuzzy sounding, maybe just your headphones. Fuzzy sounding? We got a fuzz sound? It could be. It could just be the fans and stuff. I turned most of them off. We get too hot here. The cops. Okay, thank you, Brad. That's what I thought. Hey, Andreas, how you doing? It is mean out there. It's going to be 110 here today. Do you know that? 110. I'm so excited about that. It's already 83 right here. Yesterday, at the time that I was supposed to be doing the interview with Topher Brennan, it was 96, and that was with all the fans on. So I have no idea what it would have been if I turned them all off in order for you guys to be able to hear. Oh, that's one of the reasons why it's fucked up. I didn't have that on. There we go. Anyway, compression always helps the audio peak warnings, but whatever. Freaking out about the 12th. I am freaking out about the 12th. Hey, Melissa H, how you doing? Good to see you. Soul Rebel, good to see you. Cat. All right, so let's just, before I show you the good cop story, because I'm going to show you a good cop story. Ah, cop. Good cop story. Let's just say hi to everybody. Markus, thank you for being here, sir.
Thank you, John. And hello, John. Good morning. And good morning, Steve. Good morning, Deniz. And of course, good morning, America.
Thank you so much, Markus. And Deniz, thank you for being here, sir.
Good morning, everyone. Like I used to sing when I think about bad cops. Sorry, guys. I'm totally... Let's move on. I'm out. I didn't get much sleep last night, so yeah, fuck it.
Was it because you were out at another dance fest with your date, or is it just because it was too hot there, or what? Just
family stuff. My brother has some problems at the moment, and yeah.
Sorry to hear.
Don't let us go any further. So yeah.
All right. Well, morning, everybody.
No problem.
Hey, Jupiter Judy, I am so sorry for Florida. I'll just go right there. I'm so sorry. Your poor little state is getting so pummeled by climate change, and I'm sorry. I hope you're safe. I hope you're safe, Jupiter, and everybody else. Steve got out in time, but your hurricane season coming up is gonna do some serious holy hell to your coastline. Just know that, and have a nice day. Thank you for joining us on You're Gonna Die Sooner Than... No, just kidding. Anyway.
Climate, a change you can believe in.
Ooh, nice. Nice. If climate change needed a slogan running for office.
Yeah, exactly.
Which, as destructive of a force as it is, not that it's preferential in any way, but just being what it is, that would be a great thing to pair with Trump. I mean, that's why that's why he's the face of it. Anyway, get out of Florida while you still can. Absolutely. I know Jupiter's laughing. He's like, we're not laughing. We're serious. We're scared for you. We really are. Sorry. So we'll talk about that more later. Hey, Jeffrey, how you doing? Bev, good to see you. I'm just going to show you the good cop story. So it's right in the middle of looking at that Tennessee story. And I'd seen that come out several days ago. I was waiting to see what was going to happen. I was waiting to see how many other newspapers were going to come out with it. And Democracy Now! Hit it. And I was like, okay, it's in Democracy Now! We'll talk about this now. Not that I needed them to legitimize it. It was like, let's just wait. This is the one good cop that I know and trust, Mike Butler and Dan Benavidez. And every week, they send me an email. Dan sends me an email with Mike's comments on their walk, their weekly walk. There's always somebody that goes with them. Sometimes it's people from another state. Sometimes it's representatives from their state. Sometimes it's police chiefs from other states, other cities. I mean, they're a nationally known entity. They've gone to Washington, D.C. They've done speaking. I'm supposed to bring them both on the show. And the reason I haven't, the reason I keep delaying and sending them emails and going, Dan, I'm so sorry. It's not that I don't want to have you on the show. It's that I haven't had the time to build the show that I want to have with you. Like, I want to do it right. I want to put together something that shows what they've done for the last 2 years. I don't want to just show a bunch of fucking slides I want to do it right. And that's why. So they continue to do work. They continue to get recognized. I'm just going to put this up and read to you. Dan usually talks about what he sees along the way. And they go to different places in their neighborhood. And they came across this one area where a young man was loading a U-Haul. And they said, what's going on? Where are you moving to? And he said, Super 8 Motel. Our family's moving out because our rent continues to be raised because Longmont's an up-and-coming city, and it's probably the most progressive city in Colorado. But outside of that, that entire area is a really nice prime area to move to. My dad's house value has gone through the fucking roof. Remember, my dad lives in Longmont, right? And even though there's fracking all around the place, People move to Colorado because weed. People move to Colorado because many other reasons, but weed's a big one. So rent, and this is happening in other places where they legalized weed, and it's not just weed, but it's one of the primary reasons why rent has gone, you know, skyrocketing. Also income inequality and continued poor wages and, you know, all the things that we're fighting to change. So here's family that's another victim of that. And here's Mike Butler, police chief. Really not his responsibility to fix that. I mean, he's the chief of public safety. So he's involved with more than police chiefing. He does fire chiefing. And he does structure, infrastructure. And you know, so he does a lot. But it's not his job to make sure homeless people have homes. But that's what he did. He's like, well, wait a minute. We can't let this happen. We need to call on some people. We need to have a fundraiser. We need to do something about it. Besides saying, well, thank you for your support in the next election. I don't know how he gets put into office. But, you know, that would be a political walk. This is Mike Butler, cop, and Dan Benavidez, Latino leader in the community. When they meet some people who become their friends, it's not like, well, boy, that sucks for you. We're off to a Starbucks. See you later. You know? And look, I'm guilty of the same. I'm guilty of that. I think we all kind of are because we don't really know what to do. I can't stop what I'm doing and go fix that problem. It needs to be fixed on a greater level. We have to work collectively to fix that problem, right? The fact that there are a whole bunch of people living without homes down at the river where Steve has his mobile home right now while he waits to find a permanent spot, right? That's not the fault of those individuals. It's the fault of society for not caring for everybody as much as we seem to care for corporations. But I can't fix it by acting alone, right? It takes collective action. Anyway, when you're a leader in your community, like Mike Butler and Dan Benavidez are, you can take action because you have power in your hands. You have the resources to do something at a larger scale. Another reason to take local power. Just saying. And a good fucking cop story. One. Every week I can give you another good cop story like this one. From the one good cop I know. One. There you go. And I see the audio levels just going all over the place. I'm sorry, guys. I don't know what's up with this. Obviously, there's something wrong with my audio because I don't even have it coming in my earpiece. So I really got to figure that out. But it's difficult to do that when you're live, believe it or not. No, we're moving past that. What's the next thing? Oh, it's these guys. Go back to the card. Thank you. And why does this keep doing this? Stop doing that. I need to have a limitation of liability at the beginning of the show that just says your eardrums are not my fault. Just sorry. Okay, here's the card. Let me show you what I'm talking about so that these guys can get on with their report on Tunisia and women's rights and Islam. Gonna learn some stuff. I like that video you dropped, Deniz, by the way, that one, explaining the difference, explaining what the word jihad means and the other words and how we're Americanizing or getting them confused. That's like that. Anyway, we'll get to that. So let's see the card. Events. Summer for Progress is just an all-around effort to get all of the existing Democrats and maybe other representatives that give a shit to agree to pledge to these things that the American people want. And it's a great litmus test for people who want to be candidates to find out if if they were in office, would they sign on to it? So Summer for Progress, hashtag People's Platform. Make sure you're pushing that out. And Countable is an app that I'm always pushing because it allows you to share how you feel on something, make a vote, and share that vote with your representative. So please log into Countable, use Countable, enjoy the power of your voice. If nothing else, this is the precursor to what will become a modern democracy where we have direct contact with our representatives through social media, through the internet, and we can see what they're doing, when they're doing it, and we can tell them as our servant what we want them to do. Anyway, 8:12 with Nina Turner in Iowa. That's going to be an interesting, awesome, cool event. I'm scared to death about it. And then Eclipse the Establishment on 8:21. That is going to be a blast, and we're getting ready to do We're going to have a ball. We were looking at the rundown for that. We're going to make this a fundraiser for candidates. All right. So we'll do dedications of music to candidates. You guys share with us that you donated $2, $5, whatever it happens to be. And we'll be playing music. We'll be running Bernie tunes. We'll be watching the eclipse through Live View Solo and Ashley Terry and his big, expensive, fancy pants cameras. And he's been studying all the different shots because there's a whole bunch of cool shit you can look at when you see an eclipse like this. So we're going to have a fun time from 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. at least. And I even have a graphic. Well, that's not the right one. I have this graphic, but that's not the complete graphic. Give me a second here. I got to load the other one here. This one's, it's a tease, everybody.
Yeah.
Promotional tease. One moment. Why you stare at that one? Where'd I drop it? All right. I don't have it. I don't know what I did with it. I'll put it up later. It's a full event graphic. I think it's ready to go. Actually, I may just put it up there and create the event today. It's going to be awesome, Jeffrey Pearson, and we'll have a music box list that you guys can choose from, and you can suggest other songs if you want, and we can check them. We'll give you a link to check them on YouTube. So if you want to do some work for us and make sure the song's okay to play, we'd appreciate that. This is so we don't get the event shut down, you know, by running YouTube songs we can't run. But there's so much good music that we could run, and we're doing this. You know, it's got to be related to the sun, the moon, the earth, science. Stretch it however you want. Environment. That's where we're going. All right. So that's all that. I have requests. I have requests. In order to make this August event happen on the 12th, not the eclipse thing. The eclipse thing is going to be good. Got that handled. The event in Iowa, I have a request. If there's anybody out there in Iowa that is near Des Moines or in Des Moines and can give Scott Galindez a hand, just doing anything, even if it's just being a point of contact for me to know what the hell he's doing while he's there, because he's going to be really busy, please reach out. If you're sketchy, if you're not sure you can do it, don't worry about it. I need someone that's like, I got absolutely nothing to do, and I am wholly dedicated to being able to spend that time. That's my first request. I'm not expecting anybody to be in that position, okay? So I don't want anybody having guilt trips over this. I'm just throwing out like fairy tale unicorn and rainbow fucking dreams right here, okay? The next one's going to make you laugh even harder because this is even more of a fucking dream, all right? It's an F-bomb deserve a dream. Anyway, excuse me. The next one is if anybody has a laptop, I know, I told you, it's ridiculous. Anybody has a laptop that they're ready to donate to the cause, it can either have Thunderbolt connection or USB 3 connection, because these are the two ways that I can bring a decent camera into a Google Hangout with Scott. He's got a laptop. We need it. I got to get him another laptop. I mean, I can do this other ways, and maybe some people there have laptops, but I'm guessing they're all going to want to be busy with those. And so people have been asking, what do you need? What can we get? What's the primary thing? That is really like, if there was one piece of gear that Scott and I have been lacking forever, it is a laptop dedicated to travel, not my boat anchor that I purchased, that one is not viable, and I need it here. So Thunder, either Thunderbolt capable, a new Thunderbolt, not old Thunderbolt, a new Thunderbolt cable, or a USB 3. That's ridiculous. Nobody has one of those things to just hand out to Scott these days. But if you're in the Iowa area, if you're like, I could part with my really expensive, awesome laptop for a week while Scott uses it, great. The reason I say this, and the piece that's not too crazy, is when we become a nonprofit, if, assuming all this goes down, you have plenty of time within the year, you get a real receipt from us as a nonprofit for the donation, whether it be of the time or of the unit entirely, and now you can write that off on your taxes. That's what I got to offer you back on that. So there you go. Jupiter Judy, how new? It needs to be able I would say we're 2017, huh? I would say if it's older than 2014, it's probably not, it's sketchy. It's possible. 2012 was my cutoff because the Thunderbolt devices and the USB 3 didn't even exist until a couple years ago anyway, or a year ago. So it's not, it's like that's set. The technology alone sets your date, your times, basically. If it's got functional Thunderbolt, then it's new enough. If it's got functional USB 3, then it's new enough. There you go. Those are the two inputs that I'm dealing with there. Both pretty modern, right? Anyway, now we're going to... And thank you guys for listening. That was a whole lot of shit just get out there. And the reason we're running the next piece is because I need time to shut up. Give me the 9 hours ahead card, please. Boom. What do we got going on now? We got 9 hours ahead. World News Review with... Katie's not here today, unfortunately. She's got something going on with family. But Deniz and Markus, Katie's been invited. Right. And today's topic is Tunisia, women's rights, and Islam. Markus, Deniz, I don't even have you guys in a shot. Let's put on Markus first. Thank you for doing this today.
thank you for letting us do this. And let's address first Katie. Katie cannot be with us until September because she's on holidays, or she will go on holidays. Okay. And she has a lot of family stuff right now to do. And this is why she cannot be with us. But she said every time she has a little bit time, and she will drop links, and we will keep her in we will keep her informed what we are talking about. And if she has suggestions, we include all these suggestions, of course. And and today we are, of course, like every day, we are 9 hours ahead. And we are not addressing a EU topic, but we are going to Africa right now, because in the last week there was a very interesting news coming up, and it was reporting about Tunisia, and that they passed a law which prohibits now any violence against women, and they strengthened the women's rights in Tunisia. And as an Islamic country, I was very astounded, because I think I'm no expert about Islam. I'm a Christian, of course, and I don't know much about it. And I was astounded because I always thought that suppression of women is part, not of the religion, but part of the culture. And but it seems to be not like this, because, as I said, Tunisia is an Islamic country, and they are coming up so progressive. And Deniz has more information on this. Deniz?
Yeah. But before we start the whole discussion, I would like to that John plays the video to that we have an idea what's going on in Tunisia at the moment.
Hang on, guys. We're getting that video loaded up. But there was another video we decided to run. So we've got to stop it. Like, stop that. All right, this is the Tunisia video.
That's the right one.
My apologies. Here we go.
No problem.
Physical, moral, sexual, and economic aggression against women. Incorporating UN guidelines on human rights and gender equality, it's the first law to specifically shield women from violence. It eliminates the controversial rule that allows a child rapist to escape punishment if he marries his victim.
What does it say about Tunisian children? If a 13-year-old girl agrees to marry...
No, there's another one running still.
Yep.
Right there.
Oh, fuck.
Sorry, guys. Give me a minute. We're going to go back and run this from the beginning because...
All right.
The Hill just has these autoplay videos going on. Another reason why we got to stop using the system that we're using now. Every freaking news site does this shit these days. Because we do what we do. Here we go.
Women's rights. You'd be hanging out in here, so if you need...
Nope. There's something else still. Right there.
Again.
Right click and mute it, please.
Okay, guys, then let's drop the video and start directly with the discussion.
All right, hang on. Okay. Now let's run it again. We're
Hold on.
We just have to mute the tabs. From the beginning. My bad, everybody.
No problem.
Historic moment for women's rights in Tunisia. As lawmakers pass a bill to end all physical, moral, sexual, and economic aggression against women. Incorporating UN guidelines on human rights and gender equality, it's the first law to specifically shield women from violence. It eliminates the controversial rule that allows a child rapist to escape punishment if he marries his victim.
What does it say about Tunisian children? If a 13-year-old girl agrees to marry a 40-year-old man, it's shameful and history will remember.
It criminalizes sexual harassment in public spaces and workplace discrimination. There will also be harsher penalties for violence committed within the family. The legislation includes provisions for legal and psychological support for the victims, but fails to set out how the government intends to fund these landmark policies. Nonetheless, it's a victory for Tunisian women's rights campaigners who've demanded a domestic violence law for decades. Despite being seen as a pioneer of women's rights in the Arab world, nearly half of all Tunisian women reportedly experience some form of domestic violence in their lives.
Thank you. Guys, I would like to start then. The thing is, I have to start to tell you guys, in Islam, women and men have the same right under the religion. So that means if you hear these kind of stories that the women are mistreated and so on, this is a cultural thing, a patriotical thing, and it has nothing to do with the religion. Tunisia is a special place in the Islamic world because Tunisia always was a liberal state. It never was something like Saudi Arabia and all other countries. Yeah, Markus. So let's go back to you then.
But what makes Tunisia so different than other Islamic countries? What's so special about them? Are they practicing a different Islam? What is so special about them?
Yeah, like I said before, Tunisia is a liberal state. Therefore, they're practicing a liberal kind of Islam. But we have to go to the other thing. You guys probably know there are two big movements in Islam. We have the Sunnis and we have the Shia. And this whole thing, the whole conflict between these two movements goes back to the time after our prophet, the founder of the religion, died. There was a family affair because his son-in-law, Ali, proclaimed to be the new leader of Islam. And his father-in-law, Muhammad's father-in-law, proclaimed he will be the leader of the religion. Ali, the son-in-law, represents the Shia side. And the father-in-law represents the Sunni side. So, and this is the struggle of the whole political stuff today. So, yeah.
Okay, then I just gotta say that it is not only that is not about the two new Islam movements, Sunni and Shias, but it is only a political factor. It is only a device to keep political power in the right hands. Or am I wrong?
Yeah, in today's terms, we have to go a little bit in the past so that you can see the whole context. In Islam, it's said, and this is the rule of today's, in today also, you have to respect any other religion. You have to let them practice their faith, build their temples, mosque, church, and so on. And in today's terms, we, after the vanishing of the Ottoman Empire, where in the time of the 500-600 years, there were peace around every religion, Jews, Christians, the two big movements in Islam and so on, they all lived peacefully. But after after World War II, World War I, all the other countries were founded, and now we have the divide in the Islamic world because between the Shias and the Sunnis.
So you mean in the Osmanic Empire, the religions lived equally together, and there was no there was no quarrels, there was no aggression, and I didn't know this. And after and you said after World War One, after the Osmanian Empire collapsed, all the new countries emerged, and why didn't they keep the religion they lived in the Osmanian Empire?
No, there was no difference in the there is in today's regard there is no one true Islam. Do you know what I mean with this?
Okay.
We have the two movements who proclaim to be the true followers of Islam and of Allah. So we came back to Tunisia. In Tunisia, they practice, in my view, in my eyes, the true form of Islam. Because we have to go to the women. The women have the right, for example, in Islam, if they want to divorce, they can divorce. But also, an Islamic and a Muslim women don't have to take the name of their man if they get married, so, for example. And go back to the divorce. If the Muslim couple decide to divorce the marriage and so on, the Muslim man has also to take care of his wife and the children after the divorce. So you can see. And I would like to go if John could put it on a screen, the five pillars of Islam. And here you will see, this is the foundation of Islam. This is something I follow, and this is what all Muslims have to follow. So hey, I'm waiting.
Hang on, Deniz.
Okay.
I'm getting that slide ready, but I have a question for you. Okay?
Yeah.
Because I understand where you're going here, and I see that you're telling me that in Tunisia, so if I understand what you're trying to say, you're trying to separate culture
from
religious
faith.
So that the culture is enforcing the sexism, the patriarchy,
not
religion. And I just got to turn that around on you, man, and say, for as passionate as you seem to be, and we see in the Muslim world, as the Islam world, we see about how passionate you are about your religion. And you're describing the correct Islam you are describing to me. But in my view, Tunisia practices the correct Islam. Why aren't you working so hard for those equal rights over the cultural provisions? You seem to be totally cool with accepting the cultural provisions. They wear burqas. They have to. They can't drive over there. That's just because of it. That's the way Islam is over there. I can accept that. That's their version of Islam. To me, it's an excuse to say, oh, no. That's culture. That has nothing to do with our religion. And I think that's bullshit. I think that's absolute fucking bullshit. That's like saying the Catholic Church had no influence over the culture of the United States of fucking America.
Okay. I wouldn't put it like this. I would say, of course, culture and religion are connected with each other very deeply. There's no question about it. It is always a question. Look at America. About the ultra right winger Christians. Would you describe them to be Christians in the Christian way? From what we learned to believe in Jesus and he as a role model. Are those guys really following the Christian way? I think not. And I think it is culturally it might be much stronger in those countries. Because you got to see the community works differently, in my opinion. And there are, of course, there are prejudices, and there is maybe for us a backward thinking. But this kept those societies alive. And I think if they are moving forward and they're trying to move to a progressive way, I think it is not wrong. I see what you mean, John. But I think we have to always we cannot put the American culture and compare it with the Arabian or the Islamic culture. It is different somehow, you know.
Well, that would imply, I guess, in my opinion, that somehow the humans are different over there. But I understand what Tunisia is doing.
Listen, John.
Guys, I was born here in Germany. I grew up with a Turkish father and a German mother. But I was raised in the Islamic tradition. But I have my Western influence. I have my I like to go out and this and that and go dancing and so on and so on. But there's a certain point where I stop, where other go further, because I have my roots. We have our roots, and I follow them. Because please, John, please put the five pillars on, so that I can better describe the whole thing.
Yeah, we're gonna look at the five pillars. Steve's too busy typing in chat. I gotta pull it up myself.
I have no influence of what is going on the screen. So, yeah.
I realize that sometimes I don't either, Deniz.
So guys, here you can see what the doctrine of Islam is based on. These are the five big rules that you as a Muslim have to follow. First rule, Shahada. Shahada means declaration of faith. That means I do everything for my faith, and I obey the rules, and if I can talk to people and say to, hey, this is Islam, and if they want to follow, hey, okay. But if they know that they're another religion, I respect them. Second, Salat. Salat means obligatory prayer. This means you, as a Muslim, you have to pray five times a day. Third rule, Sakat, compulsory giving. This is one thing that in the whole MSM and Western media and politics and so, it's totally out. For example, in Muslim and Islamic countries, it's forbidden, for example, if you want to have a bank loan, to take interest or to put interest on the loan, for example. Or if someone is hungry or homeless, you give them shelter, give them something to drink, to eat, and so on. This is something you as a Muslim have to do. And this is something I enjoy doing, because there's nothing better than to help another human. The fourth rule, Sahan. Sahan means fasting in the month of Ramadan. As you guys witnessed it, that I did it, yeah. And the biggest rule or the biggest achievement as a Muslim is the pilgrimage to Mecca. It is the duty of every Muslim to do this in his lifetime, and yeah. But there are other places you can do your pilgrimage if you are not fortunate enough to go there. And for every rich Muslim, it is his duty, if he knew someone who is poor or so on, and to give him the money so that he can do his pilgrimage, for example. Yeah. And
Okay, go on.
Yeah. No, you want to say something? Hey.
Okay, what I see from the five pillars is that the first three pillars are serving for everyone's personal life, while the others are more or less, if you want, so dedicated to God. And it is, to me,
it is seen as the whole concept is dedicated to God, because you do a service not only to God but also to your community, to your people, and so on.
This is what I mean. This is what I mean. But the first three have more or less direct influence on your personal life.
On your personal life. So,
this is what I want to say.
You have any other questions? Well, you, John.
Compulsory giving is a personal life thing? That I mean, I'm just reading.
Yes, I think so. If you are a receiver,
okay,
for example, you are, well, if you're a giver or receiver, it is a connection between it.
Well, sure. No, all right. Well, I guess I think this is lovely, and it looks very similar to something that Christians have. You know, the Ten Commandments or the basic rules in the Torah. You know, the rule of the internet: don't be a dick. But there's a lot in here that's just basically dedication to God, pilgrimage yes. to Mecca, fasting.
Yes, this is what I mean. This is what I mean.
Prayer,
with the left
yeah.
decoration.
Plus, yeah.
I see, guys, in the chat. I see the chat, and you say, "Hey, science has nothing to do with religion. Has nothing to do with science." Guys, do you know that some science of today have the foundation in Islamic countries
yes.
and from the past? For example, the operations, if you have something with your eyes, like you losing your sight, the operation with the lens to put it right through back and so on, was invented 500 years ago from an Islamic Muslim scientist and doctor.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so on. In the Arabic world, in the Islamic world, science and knowledge was worshipped. It was acknowledged. It was there were places for everyone if they want to pursue a certain kind of science field and so on. They could do it. They would not be challenged or killed or something. Not that happened in Europe, for example, in that time.
That's okay. A very big point. That's a plus side of Islam, everybody. If you were on yeah. the Christian side of things, science was basically poo-pooed, held back, and
exactly.
Christians preferred dark ages and crusades.
Yes.
So yes.
And there's one less aspect I would like to discuss with Deniz is what is about the term jihad? We all know jihad, and yeah. what we in the Western culture mostly understand is terrorism and war. What is jihad from a religious point of view from the Quran?
Jihad is such a big word. It's not big kind of word only to wage war or something. For example, in Islam, it is forbidden to kill. It is or to do harm to others. It is only accepted in self defense. So therefore. When we go back to jihad as a word, it means struggle in English. So, if you, for example, I as a Muslim can go to the next mosque and can say I want to start a jihad against world hunger, for example, so that my fellow Muslim brothers and sisters will agree with this and we will start to fight, for example, world hunger. It is nothing. There's also a real strong verse, a strong sentence in the Quran. If you kill one innocent human, it is like you kill the whole of humanity. There you can see what the difference is, what the Western and the whole MSM narrative is about jihad. They are such uneducated around the subject and throwing it in and indoctrinate the people about it, that is something only bad. Of course there are these idiots who are misusing it and kill innocent people and so on. But these people are not Muslims. These are crazy fucking idiots and nothing more.
Okay. This was very clear. And there is one last thing to come back to Tunisia. And the latest news I heard about it after the law was passed that even Morocco now, not even, that Morocco also discusses to pass the same law. And I think if this goes on, it would mean a big progress for human rights in the Islamic world. And of course, there is... There is something we should also mention, that it is it needs to be financed, and that's it. What might be difficult because the law is passed, but the money seems to lacking to take care for the women who experience domestic violence, for example, so-called women houses. Or what about lawyers? They need lawyers to be educated on those topics, and all this needs monies. And there is a human rights activist. Her name is Amna Gulali, and she demands from not demands, but she wants us to invest in this country in the new laws they passed and to help them because without the help from other countries the situation would not change. And I think it's important to do this. And Deniz, you have an opinion on this?
Of course. Hey, you all are welcome to support this issue and give money and suggestions and support, but to a certain point. You have to stop at a certain point, because don't dictate them what they have to do. These women, these Muslim women, Muslims are very, very proud. The people are not in Africa, in North Africa and in Middle East and so on. These people are very proud. And don't hurt their being, because they fought for this struggle. They want this. Not they fight it and fight. But if you go too far in and mess too much yeah, in the whole thing, it will stop at the point when the people will say, for what did we fight for this? Why?
Yes.
That the West and other foreign nations and so on dictate us what we should do? And this is something very, very, very dangerous. So,
I fully agree. And yes, it was their fight. And of course, if they decided it, their laws and the Western countries or the world should help them to establish this. And no demands on how they do it and where they do it. And they should be invited to come to other countries and to see how women rights are practiced there, and to take the best for their countries, for their culture, whatever they think is good for them. And this should be offered, in my opinion. And we will see what's what will develop there, and we will stick on the topic, of course.
This is the topic we could for the whole show, and I would never get all the information, all the stuff in it. So, I hope you guys enjoyed it. So,
See you next week. I think we can. The next 9 hours ahead, would be next week on Friday, because the Wednesday show is no awake anymore. Okay. Thank you for watching. I hope you liked it. And if I miss questions, please drop them under the YouTube video and we'll answer them. Thank you.
That was a great discussion. It's a great conversation. And just to clarify there, everybody, I was not debating, and I'm not trying to pick a fight with Deniz about Islam, but I am trying to bring out a point that there's a lot of similarities between what's supposed to happen in Islam and what actually happens in Islam, just like Christianity, right? It's supposed to be this way, and the truth is, if everybody was the way it was written down, then there wouldn't be factions. It's just like Christianity. If everybody actually was a true practicing Christian, there wouldn't be these different groups arguing over stupid bullshit, which doesn't really lend a lot of cred to the whole thing in the first place. It's supposed to be created by a god. I
fully agree. There is much to be criticized, not only in the Islamic world, but also in the Christian world. But I think it is important to show where developments are and where progressiveness is seen. And we should support them and encourage those people to go on.
Well, right, yeah. I mean, the bottom line is, it's not like we're going to... My yelling at it isn't going to get rid of it. The people have to evolve, and there they go. So, yeah, they're evolving in the right direction. Good for them. And that's what we promote, right?
I personally also don't agree with everything that is in the faith, but this is my struggle that I have with the faith, and this is something I have to get to solutions and so on. But hey, I welcome every other opinion, and I respect every other view. And guys, I love that you guys give me the chance to talk about it, to get a little bit information and so on out. And hope you guys, if you are really interested, research.
Yes. Yeah. Research, find out the fun history of both religions. Anyway, it's all sorts of good stuff in there. Thank you guys. And good conversation you guys are having out there. Moving forward, that's good. Congratulations for Tunisia and women's rights if they manage to fund whatever they're doing there. That's a typical American thing too, like education. Let's make this program, but then let's not give it any money, because, right, that, we do that all the time. Moving on, everybody, we're going to talk politics. I marked a few things as being top news, but really, it's all just kind of ground game news. This is a Democratic rising star, Kamala Harris, has a Bernie Land problem, and she does, because she's attached to Wall Street. But there's, listen, so here's where things get fuzzy for me, and they kind of do, simply because what are we going to do in this case? We don't want her running for president, but this is who they're picking, right? Scroll down to the bottom of this if you can. I want to just get to the summary. Hey, it's scrolling. Look at that. Yeah, keep going. Right. Did you see that guy, Steve Mnuchin? He donated to her campaign in 2016. She's got a lot of hill love. Yeah. She's one of the only people to vote against a particular piece of legislation that Mnuchin was pushing for because he's a dick, and he donated to her campaign. That right there just makes me go, ew, why would you take that money? That would be a cool thing if candidates could give back a donation. And if they would, right? Exxon sends you cash like, I'm not interested in taking your blood money. Send it back. But here's the bottom line. Winnie Wong jumps in. There's a lot of opinions in here one way or the other. And Winnie Wong jumps in, she is the preferred candidate of the extremely wealthy and out-of-touch Democratic Party donors, said Winnie Wong, co-founder of the group People for Bernie, which played a prominent role in the grass movements behind Senator Sanders in 2016. Her recent anointing is extremely telling. These donors will line her coffers ahead of 2020, and she will have the next 2 years to craft a message of broad appeal to rapidly changing electorate. That's Hillary 2.0. That's where they're going right there. Organizers like Wong have signaled, this is where it gets tricky. Tricky. This is where it makes me think of Macron. A little bit. Organizers like Wong have said that there is still time for Harris to win over their side of the party in order to present a unified Democratic message. Okay. When Winnie Wong says something like that, I trust her words. Okay. If she wants to advance her political career, she will have to come out authentically and honestly in support of universal health care, free college, a federal $15 minimum wage, criminal justice reform, and the expansion of Social Security programs. Anything less than this means the party will continue to bleed voters. I'm with you. I agree 100%. That's people's platform stuff. Markus is nodding his head. Deniz is going, and Steve's over here going, yeah. Yeah. He's like, yeah, man.
Yeah.
I'm just reading the chat. Sorry, guys. That's fine.
That's fine. Hey, Ashley Terry. Hey, Chad. Lupkes, by the way. Xander. Lily, how you doing? Sandy. Hi. Wesley. So here's the problem with that statement, because her words coming out of Kamala Harris' mouth, Harris has already come out supporting all five of those policies. The problem is that she's taken money from people that don't want those policies implemented. And that's a conflict of interest. If we were living in a normal democracy that didn't have corporations equal in value to human beings. But what do we do here? And she's going for the 2020 presidential bid. That needs to be, if she wants to be on the ticket with Bernie, that would be an interesting consideration for her to take over after she's been retrained by Bernie, right? To remove the corporate cash from her body and cleanse herself of that. You know, we'll see what happens.
Do you really think so?
I don't know. No, I don't.
Okay, then we agree.
I think the fact that she said that she supports all of these things is just a way of gaining voter appeal right now, hoping that it'll just push her through. And I think what's going to happen is she's going to backslide on these by going, oh, well, I approve of it, but not with this, or not with this, or they just didn't write it the right way, or now is not the time, or blah, blah, blah. I think she's going to incremental the shit out of it.
It's only optics.
Yes.
It's only optics.
Yes.
There's no content.
Yes.
So forget about her.
Yes. And Manimus 11 says, who will she betray, her donors or her voters? I that's the and therein lies the big challenge. in order for her to really gain the support of the people, she's got to stay away from too much corporate money, right? She's got an interesting challenge here. The DNC is going to pump as much money as they can into that. And that's all going to be Clinton Foundation cash that they're rounding up right now. But she knows that at the voting booth, she needs the support of the people. And that's going to be seen by small donations, the number of small donations. I don't think that's going to be there. In other words, even if you, here's what I'm saying. Even if we end up liking her, don't donate. Okay.
How should that happen?
What?
How should that happen?
Well, right. Well, just, you know, save your money for candidates that actually fucking need it. She's writing on Clinton cash. That's what I'm saying. So, you know.
That's disqualifies her already. So
it should. It should.
So why should there a time coming that we should like her for what, for heaven's sake?
I'm going to answer you with this statement. Tunisia.
Okay.
You telling me I got to work with what's there?
I got it. It's okay.
That's Tunisia. Fucking, we're stuck there. Tunisia.
Right? This, the answer to all questions is Tunisia.
What? Oh, wait. I'm looking at it. We got a Xander's yelling at us in chat. Cenk owned Ben Shapiro so hard on at Politicon. Really? I haven't seen any of the Politicon stuff. None of it. Where are we at in topics? What was next? Hang on. That was a good place. Bernie problem. Oh, moving on. Trump's base. Some surprising information. Some good information. And then just some like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, I just, really. It's just the stupid. Trump's base sticks with him, according to this NBCNews.com poll with, you know, whoever that guy is there. I can't even remember his name. I hate him. We made so much fun of him over the primaries. I can't even. Chuck Todd. That's Chuck Toad. That's who that is. Excuse me. I've got some great newsroom covers making fun of Chuck. There he is. That's all right. We can. I don't want to hear him. He's annoying to listen to. Just stay away from me. Basically, what this shows, scroll down because we got some pictures. There we go. President Trump net approval. In these states, he's doing rather well. How's that for frightening?
Okay. Right.
So we got Wyoming. He's up. North Dakota, up. West Virginia, up. Scroll down. Remember, this is all one poll. All right. And we got audio peaking all over the place. In Iowa, though, we got a net -4, and in Ohio, -1. That's good news for us. And then here we go, Arizona, Texas, and Georgia. Surprisingly, for all three, down, 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 almost into triple digits or double digits there. That's good. Is there another one? I can't remember. Yeah, here's another one. Wisconsin down, Michigan down, Pennsylvania. Michigan's at -10, Pennsylvania -9, Wisconsin -9. This is all good. These are the places we need to focus on. Why do we need to focus on these places? Scroll back up to the top again. These are the swing. Basically, a lot of those, and we're going to get, there's a different article I got, but a lot of those coincide with are what are swing states. These are states that voted Obama previously that flipped over to Trump that can easily flip back if we give them somebody worth a shit that's not Hillary Clinton or Kamala Harris.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, but John, is this thinking to just focus on these states, but also a reason why
we don't hear
election petitions and candidates only coming all these 4 years to this state and do then something for them. This thinking of just focusing on these states. You, like Bernie said, you need a 50 state strategy.
Sure,
exactly.
That's a priority list. Of course, we have to do 50 states, but that's the priorities right there. States that we can attack now and win more of the voters over first, which is the same states, by the way, that the Trump team and Team Ryan, all those assholes are working on, right? Ryan in Wisconsin, I think Wisconsin or Ohio, I never remember.
They are, those states which went down are vulnerable now, and we should go after them.
Right, that's the better word, Deniz. They're vulnerable. So we need to go after them because this is war. That's what I'm talking about, right? This is war. I'm not after the people. I'm just after control, right? Yeah. We need the narrative. We need control of the narrative in these states. That is the key, okay? If what these people are watching on TV, if what they're seeing on the internet is our message or more of our message than it is their message, we win. However that message is getting out, okay, that's whether it's on TV, whether it's people knocking on doors, people making phone calls, doesn't matter. It's about the narrative. That's how we win. So the narrative in those states can be changed because people have already flipped sides because they just don't know who the hell to trust. Right. Wow, that guy's got the most serious effing look on his face, doesn't he? Wow. That's what you looked like last night talking to the cop?
Yeah.
Steve's been, I can't even get into the story. Steve's got the thing with cops going on, and I can't even get into it because it's just so, can't believe it.
Crazy.
Yeah. Somebody bought an eBay voting machine? What? With people's data? What? Somebody bought one of our voting machines on eBay with 600 voters' data in it? Come on. That's like the pinnacle of democracy for sale, right? I mean, that's literally democracy for sale.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Can you imagine how many pills those old politicians are on? Who was the guy? Speaking of pills and stupid stuff, some senator somewhere or some representative, I think he was in I don't know. I think he's a Republican. He's a Republican senator who was pushing for legal marijuana use. And he goes, you know, for some people, marijuana works so much better than opioids. I'm thinking, that would probably be for all people. They just don't know because they don't have access. And I'd like to ask the guy making the statement, have you tried? I realize your buddy with pharma and you get your opioids for free, but have you tried using cannabis? Everybody would do better. Trust me. I'm like, that's part of the narrative problem, right? Instead of saying some people do better, it's no, this is a safer, more affordable, more controllable, doesn't cause death, isn't addictive. You could smoke it for 30 years and scientific study just released says it ain't going to do shit to your lungs. Now, to clarify, does that mean that it won't leave you more susceptible to lung problems because you are inhaling smoke? No, that's a fact. That's going to happen. That's just your body and health. However, it does not increase your risk of cancer or any other carcinogens like they used to tell us in the Just Say No days. There's 30 gazillion chemicals we don't know about. No, no, we actually know what those chemicals are now. We've done science. Anyway, I just wanted to go there. Chad Lupke's one perfect. We need to live in reality as well. Yes, so Chad, I want your response. What do you think of Kamala Harris? And would you vote for her if she ended up being the ticket? No pressure. I want to know. Because Chad is one person whose political knowledge I trust. Right? I don't know jack shit. I'm just a loudmouth. I go to people like Chad. I go to people like Scott. Deniz, Markus, anybody. I don't know shit about any of this shit. All right. Melissa, we're just still on the top issues. We haven't moved far at all. No, we're on the ground. This is, I didn't even know this thing existed. Here's a short video here from Unicorn Riot, which I don't know how those guys are. I mean, those guys have a lot of good gear. I just want to say to Unicorn Riot, thank you guys for all the work you do out in the field. You bring a lot of, you bring us a lot of content. Thank you for that. This is just a video talking about the EFF, the Electronic Frontier Electronic Frontier Foundation is really cool. And they actually, I talked to them a while back when we were dealing with our First Amendment issues. And I had a good conversation with one of their very smart lawyers. And she really gave me an education on just how difficult it is to win a First Amendment case against a big giant network. And she said, basically, you have a solid case. If this were not a First Amendment case, it would be a slam dunk. But because it's a First Amendment case, and because it's against CNN, it's not a slam dunk. And therefore, I can't say that we would take the case. Those were her words to me. Now, she didn't say that they wouldn't take the case, but she said if I was going to formally ask to take the case, I had to do a lot of stuff and blah, 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 blah. And it would meant, you know, are you ready to roll down the hill with this? Are you really ready to put all that effort in? And I was not. Right. So anyway, we're going to watch this short clip about the EFF and what they're doing at DEF CON 25, which is something I've never even fucking heard of. That goes on all the time. Another one of these conventions that's happening. So here we go.
In the vendors area, talking with the EFF. Can you tell me what your name is and a little more about what the EFF does?
So I'm Cooper Quinton. I'm a staff technologist and security researcher at EFF. We're a nonprofit that's been around for 25 years, and our mission is to make sure that when you get online, your rights come with you. So things like freedom of speech, freedom of privacy, the Fourth Amendment, all exist online as well as off, and we want to defend that.
Very cool. So what brought you to DEF CON? How long have you been coming?
Yeah. So my first DEF CON was DEF CON 13. EFF has been coming for a very, very long time. And we come to DEF CON because this is our community. The hacker community is, our very first case was defending hackers.
So what's one of the biggest threats to internet freedom at this time? Like, what's a project you're working on currently?
So it's hard to say what the biggest threat to internet freedom is because there are so many threats to internet freedom. Of course, net neutrality is a big issue right now.
Yeah.
A lot of things going on with that. So we've been trying to mobilize people to contact the FCC and let them know that they would like net neutrality to remain the case. Additionally, the thing I work on is targeted attacks against vulnerable populations. So when governments want to send malware to people to spy on journalists, to spy on dissidents, and keep control over them, basically. Of course, mass surveillance is still a huge issue of the type that the NSA and certainly other governments do as well.
Sure.
A good way to get involved is to go to EFF.org, or you can go to SSD.EFF.org, and we have this is our surveillance self-defense guide. You can see a lot of information about how to protect yourself from internet surveillance.
There you go. Hey, just tell you we're not going to run into that yet. Just pause it, back it up a bit. We're going to do one more short video from that event. That was just the EFF talking about what they do. Been around for 25 years, nonprofit, fighting for our rights on the internet, and they're being taken away quickly. If you want to get involved with that or can donate, please do so. They're a good organization. So, Chad, Chad is defending his Berniness. I thank you, Chad, for your honesty. He will vote for the Democratic candidate. I am not ready to make that statement. I will vote for the candidate that I like, whether they're on the Democratic ticket or not, like I did last time. But I will hope to be supporting the Democratic candidate. Right? I certainly want to say it's the Democratic candidate. I hope by the time we get to 2020, we have affected the change that we need to affect within the party to be putting forth a candidate that is worthy of my vote. That is my statement. I'm going to work as hard as I can to make sure that we have a Democratic Party candidate that is worth my vote, because we didn't last time.
Nope.
Right? So that's what it is. And to everybody that's going on about who did Chad vote for and all that other crap, I really agree with what Michael Stapleton just said. Past is gone. All right. We move forward. And that includes Hillbots that still want to talk great things about Hillary. If you can't read WikiLeaks, if you can't read the fucking truth and get over it, then you're not moving on either. I'm ready to stop blaming Hillary for screwing us, because I need to move on and take over the Democratic Party so that they don't do it again. Okay?
Yeah.
So, don't care. Moved on. What I want to do is ensure that it never happens again. Like the cops cover, what I realized about the cop cover this morning after I was angry about it, and then I saw the good cop stories. I said, all I really need to do is take power where those cops are. And then we could eliminate them. We could write state laws that said if we ever catch cops abusing teens, we hang them from a tree. If we wanted to. Now, that would be really rude, and that would be kind of the antithesis of kinder, gentler, restorative justice. But I'm just saying, when you're in power, you get to write those laws. It's pretty powerful. When you're in power, you get to write laws that deport families for no reason. when you're in power, you get to write laws that drop bombs on children in other countries for war and oil, to sell weapons. It's amazing what you can do when you finally take power. You take state power and you can completely fuck an environment for a people like Iowa. Iowa's number one at helping to create the dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico. Number one. Go Iowa. Right? I took a lot of power to deregulate everything and make sure we were fucking up the ocean that fast. We can do the same kind of things. We can retake that power with the simple little chart that we were given by Larry Taylor the other day. And we gain XP, we level up, and we save the planet. It's the game of life. Truly is. It's just not nearly as fucking cool as Warcraft or Guild Wars or any of the online universes we've created. But it's for real, at least. It's for real. Yes, Steve Collins. Power, power, power. I mean to say it like a greedy son of a bitch, because if we want to save our asses, we need to be greedy about it. To take care of ourselves. And I've said it before. I hope a lot of corporations die. Because it's okay if they die. They're not alive. Corporations can die.
There's Chad having a question for you, John.
Yes.
John, are you a PCP in Oregon? Do you think the Democratic Party is dead?
I see that from Chad. So let me tell you what's happened in my political career. I am a PCP in Oregon. There's a neighborhood leader program that I'm supposed to get involved with that I haven't yet. I've been sent the login information, but it's been too damn hot and I've been too damn busy with this. Right? My interest is split. I'm a card-carrying Democrat, but I want to see the Democrat in Oregon be progressive. All right? The Democratic Party here is not progressive. And it may be relative to other states, but it's really not done jack shit in terms of progressive movement in the last 10, 11 years. And it's had control of all three branches, so it should be moving fucking forward, and we're not. All right. There's some people within the Democratic Party at the top level that are definitely on the corporate payroll, and I want to remove those people. My Linn County Democratic Party is moving really slow. And that's okay. I'm working with them on a website. I got a meeting with them this Friday to help them build a new website on whatever new service they picked. Right now it's on Drupal. God help them. And, so I am working with them, but I'm working with them at their pace. And I'm working with the PDPO, the Progressive Democratic Party of Oregon. It's the Progressive Caucus, which Larry Taylor chairs. I'm working with them at their pace. And they're progressive. I mean, if you wanted a more... to explain this, there's nothing... I love Nancy and Graham and all the other people that are within the Linn County Democratic Party. Don't get me wrong about that. But overall, the Democratic Party in Oregon is not nearly ready to move... with technology, with organization, with progressiveness, like the Progressive Oregon Caucus is, right? So I'm doing, we just did the first show of the Progressive Oregon with Larry Taylor. That was on Sunday, right? I had hoped to do something like that with Linn County first. I had hoped to broadcast that they're just not ready. They're not organized. They're still dealing with a lot of organizational issues within their own groups. You know, not that PDPO isn't either. They got issues. All these organizations got their issues and problems. We're all people trying to work together with limited resources and time, right? But so that's where I'm going. I want to see Oregon Democratic Party become actually progressive, sign on the dotted line for the People's Platform, sign on the dotted line for all the Bernie shit, and move forward fast with progressive shit. That's what I want to see.
Yeah.
So I'm Dem enter, but it's going to be our way. No compromise. No compromise. What is Chad saying? I missed it. Does anyone in here, the chat, believe the local Democratic Party consists of the people who show up? Fuck yes, I do. You want proof? Look at the idiots in office. They showed up. They filled out the forms to take the stupid jobs at the lower level that we were too lazy to do or didn't give a fuck about. They went and became a county commissioner. You know? And then a lot of them just waited for daddy and daddy's money. But anyway, I agree with you there. Chad. Chad Lupke's, if you believe that and you let those local meetings happen without you, then complain about those people over there making the wrong decision. How do you reconcile that? Are you talking about me, Chad?
I don't think it's quite fair.
The local meetings? I can't make the meetings, dude. Here's the thing. The Progressive Democratic Party is doing meetings online, which facilitates a meeting for everybody. Linn County Democrats are still meeting in the goddamn library once a month and then trying to have in-person meetings for committees. I don't have time for that shit. This is the 21st fucking century. If you're not meeting online for your democracy, then you're fucking your democracy. Personal opinion. Sorry. Personal opinion. They're trying to get there. Okay. They're trying to get there, but you know. What?
You didn't mean you, John.
Oh, no. Okay. Sorry. My bad. But you know, it just, that is another issue to bring up, though. Is that I'm trying to help them go there. Like, we could facilitate so much more democracy so much faster if we were using Hangouts, right? So yes. Sorry. It always is about me, Chad. It's my fucking show. Okay. Always. It's Awake with John and then some other people. Okay?
Scorpions. No more.
I have to remember not to react immediately when I see a comment and to think back 30 seconds ago as to what I was fucking talking about. I'm sorry. That's the problem here. Anyway. Jeez. It's another reason why I'd rather be producing shows. Right. Xander GC, you have a point there. People would have a lot more time to go to these meetings if they weren't struggling to fucking live. And that's another downfall of this. Tunisia. We have to work with what we've got. Tunisia's moving forward with what they got. We got the Democratic Party as it sits, or an adjoining caucus, right? Scott's working with some progressive caucus out in Iowa, right? And the Democratic Party proper, and our revolution, and other groups. We have to all work together, and that's kind of part of this thing, right? I'm a member of the Democratic Party because I want to be, because I want to see the Democratic Party succeed. But it frustrates the living shit out of me right now. So I'm a member of other groups so that I can be satisfied with what we're doing. There, that's it. That's it. Being a dick with John. Is that my new show? Yes. My face color slowly turns in.
Yeah, you're right, Marcus. A little bit, yeah.
Did I go 45 on you guys? Jeez.
the last statement, it is always about me. It is my show. This is Trump. Come on. You got to admit it.
All right. It's also any major celebrity. But you could go with this is Trump. That's fine. All right. We're moving on to other news because making fun of me just isn't cutting it today. This is just one more piece. I thought this was a cool idea. This is flash drives for freedom. And this is for North Korea, basically sending information because North Korea isn't allowed to, you know, they live in their own little bubble over there. We don't have that problem here. This is cool. And play.
Right, we are in the vendors area of DEF CON 25, and we're looking at the booth flashdrivesforfreedom.org. Jim, can you tell us a little more about it?
Flash Drives for Freedom is a program by the Human Rights Foundation designed to get information and educational materials into the most closed society in the world, North Korea. In South Korea, we partnered with North Korean defector organizations, people who've escaped, resettled in South Korea, but are working to get information back across the border to their family and friends in North Korea. Our partners were having to buy flash drives, which are the most ubiquitous way of sharing information, especially in a place like North Korea that doesn't have access to internet or any outside media. But people can share a flash drive full of information in a very concealed way, and we really believe in the power of outside information to transform a closed society. We know so many people have escaped and tell us that they were that they came into contact with a movie or a book or something that they weren't supposed to see, and it started a thought process. It started a questioning that had been really discouraged by the North Korean regime for their whole life. We're really just trying to empower people with the knowledge to make their own decisions. Everyone in the Western world has a flash drive laying around that they're not using. Well, as a matter of recycling and for the greater good, you can send it to us. We send it to our partners in South Korea, who they curate the content that goes on the drive. So it is primarily just pop culture stuff like K-pop videos and South Korean soap operas. And Wikipedia has been really great, and they created an offline version of the entire Korean language Wikipedia that's read-only that we can fit on an 8-gig flash drive. So we could kind of be like, hi, here is all of human knowledge in one stick. Start reading. DEF CON community has been incredible. Like, you know, it's a natural group of people that's really ready to stir the pot a little bit. And the ideas and the new ways that people in the DEF CON community has given us, that where we can help the North Korean people connect to the outside world, has just been transformative to this program.
I think that's brilliant. That's really smart and, you know, effective and simple and cheap. And I know I got flash drives laying around here. I don't need any more. You know? I love that. You just walk up, stick one in the wall. There. It's fantastic. Smart move. Yeah. What do we got here? So just to let you guys know, we're at like almost the end of the show. I've got like 900 tabs to go here. Go back to my main card. I want to see what's going on there. I don't even remember what the rest of the topics were. There's so many links. There's so many links for you to look at in the description today. Go enjoy all those links. We're not gonna look at them all at all. There's no We the People tonight. I didn't even talk about We the People next week, did I? Jeez, I'm terrible. Click on the next card. I totally forgot about this, guys. Hang on. Visualize the air conditioner. Go to... we'll talk about this. Air conditioner's not going to work. This garage is not sealed in any way or form that it will retain the cool or heat. Okay? It gets baked by the sun heavily. And if I were going to use an air conditioner in here, you would hear said air conditioner over anything else. I have to turn all the sound off, right? So that's, you know, I've got a small air conditioner unit. It used to run in the green room or grow room, but it's in the house. And even if I bought another one, it's not going to be quiet enough to run during the show. Right, that's the problem. This shit needs to get out of here and go elsewhere. That doesn't mean that I'm not going to run like a rally or something like that when it's 90 degrees if we need to. It just means that I don't want to do an interview of one of the few things I do where I actually try to be professional while I'm sweating. All right, that's all. But thank you guys for your, you know, if you know of a building around the Corvallis, Albany area that's leasable or that you happen to own because you're just one of those people that just owns an empty building around me and you want to just dedicate the building to the effort, contact me, info@bernie2016.tv. And same if you've got a laptop that's great that you don't want to use anymore, info@bernie2016tv. And what was the other thing I asked for? Oh, and if you happen to be in Iowa and you want to help Scott out for free on the 12th, probably get to meet Nina Turner at least. He really could use the help. info@bernie2016.tv. There's my three fantasies right there. Go to Eco Sutra. Dude. Why don't you come on out and go to Home Depot and put the insulation? I wish I had the time. Thank you for your kind thoughts. I wish I had the time to rebuild my studio to make it airtight and comfortable. I wish I did. If I had that kind of time, anyway, I appreciate it. It's why we're looking for the right alternative is to move in the right direction, which is happening. I'm excited about that. We were supposed to have Topher Brennan tonight, guys, but it's been rescheduled, and I actually don't know when it's been rescheduled, so I'm very sorry about that. Dorothy Gasquet is next week, and Chad, you interviewed Dorothy Gasquet, where I pronounced her name wrong the preceding week and then spelled her name wrong during the show. So hopefully at least we can correct those two issues for the next one and see how she's doing on her run for Congress in Washington. And then we just booked Dave Benack, Derek Crow, Michael Bracamontes, Danny Paulette, and we go all the way down to Doug Applegate there and Rick Shepard. These are people that are on our list. Somebody sent me a message somewhere, YouTube, I think it was, about Amy Villea. And on our list, there's three more people that I know of that aren't on this list now. We're just out of friggin' room on this list. There's a longer list. You guys are just seeing what's put in here. We have booked so many people for the show. So it's if there's one thing that's my primary concern, it's making sure that show, We the People, runs. Because of all the things we do for our candidates, that's the most useful. Right? This show doesn't do jack shit for our candidates. It's for us. Right? So, yeah. Markus nodding, Deniz nodding. This is for us to enjoy, right? And we're going to have candidates on and all that, but we're going to bring Jeff Erdman back on in a little while. But anyway, that's going. And big thank you to Laura Livengood for all her professional work that she's done to put this together and to keep bookings going and communicate between the people and just all sorts of shit. It's been amazing. It's about what she does. Sandy says, do I like MacBooks? MacBooks are great. Thank you. As long as it's got either a modern Thunderbolt connection or USB 3 or both. Woo. That would be great. But Sandy, you are in the process of rebuilding your devastated by climate world. I mean, you know, focus on that, unless you got some friend who's just got a stash of MacBooks they want to hand out. What else in the card? See, ground game focus, DEF CON. All right, we'll run that tomorrow. There's a link in there to an ad. Yeah. No, we're going to run this today. Find that. Where's this? Let's go to this Twitter here. Pause that. There's some great clips from Al Gore. He did a town hall. I haven't even listened to any of them, but if you want to click on those links and watch, click stop that. That's not the one I want. What's this Twitter? That Twitter. This. Pause that. We'll run this again. Or rewind. Yeah. This is... So, have any of you heard of Lieutenant Colonel Amy McGrath? She is running for office. Where'd you go with it? Right here. All right, we're going to run this.
And we're going to start.
When I was 12 we have years more open old, audio. I knew exactly.
Never mind. We're not going to run it. I'm just going to tell you that, by the way, everybody, I'm making this announcement today. We will not be doing this format for the show ever again. From here on out, it's going to be slides and pages with no video, because the industry has done what they needed to do to stop us from doing what we're doing here. Right? So they change, we change. And today, it's just gotten to the point where it's so fucking bad, I can't even keep track anymore. So we'll be doing a different way, which is good, because it'll be improving the overall show. It's just going to change things. But we talked about this earlier. So you're going to see a better version of this. Not like it can get any worse. Check out retired Lieutenant Colonel Amy McGrath. She was the first female to fly an F-18 in combat. She's running against Kentucky's GOP Andy Barr. And she's out with a new ad. I don't know anything about her. I don't know if she's on the Dem Corp ticket or what. And so I'm trying to find out if we should support her. Is this another one of those instances where we go ahead and back it, even though is this Tunisia? Another Tunisia? It's a lot of Tunisia happening. What's the last thing I have up there besides the video? Stop blaming millennials for things. I just had to show you the headline. Stop blaming millennials for killing things that suck. This, and the reason I have this up is because millennials have taken a lot of shit, you know, for just by older people. I'm an older people. I'm not a millennial. My sister is not a millennial. My sister's in that weird generation between millennials, and I can't remember what they're called, but between, you know, just like in between Gen X, which is what I am, and millennials is my sister, and she's like on that cusp. I love this. Beer, chain restaurants, and even marriage. They're talking about David Hildebrand, right? Who's running against Dianne Feinstein in California. We've had on the program. We're going to have him back. He made a great point about this. And the point isn't... So it's not about the title. It's not about blaming millennials. It's about what you're... The fact that we're blaming the consumer for changing demand. Okay? That's really the point here. Okay. That's the problem. It's like, guess what, supplier? We don't want that shit anymore. Fuck you. We want this over here. And calling out, you know, Applebee's, some of the worst fucking food on planet Earth. Okay? I'm glad. Let's get chain restaurants like that. I'd rather see family restaurants and food carts and that shit all over the... I love that change in America, right? Growing up, there was like 10 choices of restaurant across the entire fucking United States of America outside of family things. And my family grew up on the chain restaurant thing, right? Not that we went out to dinner a lot, but we went to chain restaurants, right? And it's... That's just one of the things in here. The point being, we are in power, and the narrative being spun that we are bad people or that a generation is bad for choosing to not buy shitty beer anymore or for choosing to go get their food from someplace that serves better goddamn food or for choosing not to drive fossil fuel vehicles anymore.
Or for not trusting mainstream media or political parties.
Yes. Yes, the death of a political party, the death of a news corporation, the death of whatever it is that's not a human being is fine and fucking dandy because corporations, news entities, they're not alive. Bye-bye. No one gives two fucks about the buggy whip businesses that died after the car was created. You know, it's like, well, I'm driving my Model T. Oh, I see that Frank's whip business is out of business. Jeez, that's too bad for Frank. I hope he's got a car. You know? That's time to get a car. That's like coal miners getting new jobs. Right? Just anyway, just want to say that.
Deniz desperately wants to tell us something.
What do you want to say, Deniz?
As representative of the millennials, I want to say fuck you, baby boomers, and all the generations that came before us for doing all this shit and presenting us this situation we are in today. No healthcare in America, shitty education system. You guys, why did you let it happen? Why?
Good one.
So,
because we haven't been annihilated yet, man.
Think about it and let's move on and change the whole thing.
Yeah. Yes. If it was that easy.
That easy. Applebee's is gross. Yes, it is. Applebee's is part of a tradition in the United States that says we have to be drinking when we're out. Let's just make places to do that. That's all it was. Can we find places for adults to go have their booze and bring their kids and not feel guilty about it? Applebee's. There you go. That was essentially what it was created for. Cereal is so high in clay. Yes, it is. Eco Sutra. You guys are having a great, good conversation. Listen, I'm not going to pick on any generations. What we choose to not like anymore is our choice. We're the consumer, right? It's business that has to be brought to heel.
Yeah.
If you haven't noticed, it's hot here anyway. Actually, interesting thing about this, 2017 so far is the hottest year on record, and the charts basically show that we're headed into a fucking... It's just fun. There's a little drop down right here compared, but the line is all the way. It's ridiculous. This is not an El Nino year, so it's not. That's not the reason for this. The interesting thing that's going on with the United States, and I don't have the map to show it, is that the line is like a big arc. So where it's hot in the Pacific Northwest, it drops down, and in the Midwest right now, they're experiencing 20 degrees below average temperatures. So we're experiencing about 10 degrees above. They're experiencing 20 degrees below average for this time of year. That line is supposed to just look like this. It's a little... And now it looks like this. That is climate change. That's what we done. And as that moves, as that line, that's our new line of environment that's messing with all of our fruits and our trees and everything. Anyway, this last story is important because I realize we're really late, but this last story is important. And Markus has taken us out with a song that I've never even fucking heard of, so I don't have a story on it. California has too much pot and growers won't be able to export the surplus because the feds are assholes. And California really needs to talk to Nevada, because Nevada just declared a state of emergency and ran out of cannabis. They're right on the border. I say the two of them go talk to the CIA. Because whenever you need to get drugs into our country, the CIA is there. And California could work a deal. I'm sure they've got tunnels already built. Air America, however they want to do it. I bet you California can get their drugs into Nevada with the CIA's help. And why not? You've got one state with a surplus, another state with a deficit. Everybody wins, including the CIA, who could take their cut. Why not? Anyway, what's the song you got, Markus? Thank you all for being here, everybody. I know it was kind of a crazy show, but thank you all for being here today. What's the song, man? It's a Chocolate Watch Band.
Yeah, the Chocolate Watch Band. They were famous. They were famous in the California area. They were a pure garage rock band and had punk influences for the early time and also a little bit psychedelic. And yeah, the song we are playing today is originally recorded by the Brokes, and the Brokes emerged later to the Quicksilver Messenger Service. I don't know if those bands are familiar to you, John. And
the last one. Heard the name of the last one.
Yeah, okay. And this is a cover song of the Brokes song, I Ain't No Miracle Worker. And I think it's it fits perfectly to the situation every one of us is in our efforts to change policy, etc. I always say it's a process, and we cannot do any miracles. We have to do hard work to achieve our games, our targets. And I think this song fits perfectly because it says we are no miracle workers, but we are doing the best that we can. And yeah, this would be the message for today, for the Wednesday.
Awesome.
Let's rock.
What, Deniz?
Let's rock.
All right. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for that story, Markus. I appreciate it. Thank you both for being here and putting up with my abuse and doing the show. Appreciate that.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah. Do we have Steve Cam? We have Steve Cam. We'll see Steve Cam.
And see you tomorrow, guys. I'll see you on Friday, guys.
Yeah. There's Steve Cam, right there, working hard.
Hey. Typing in
chat. See you, everybody.
Okay, guys. Bye.
Bye. Go be your democracy. Quit complaining about everybody else. Jeez.
Don't build your dreams too high. I'll beg you to remember, I'm just an ordinary guy. No miracle worker, I'll be the best in the can.
Ha 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 ha! Did you?
Vacuum? Yes. I also clean my bathroom and your bathroom.
Nice. You earned your Wi-Fi back.
How about my skateboard?
Find your awesome with Xfinity XFi.
It's Hack Across the Planet.